say you are what you eat, so I don't eat chicken feet. But I love me some of Grandma's pickled beets. Well, cut it up, put it in the pan, throw it over your shoulder and see where it lands right here in the farmer's kitchen. Maters, taters, beans and corn, the cows in the barn and the sheep's been shorn, kids in the barnyard chasing Grandpa's chicken. Spices, slices, cuts and dices, gonna slash your grocery prices right here in Farmer's Kitchen. Help you grow your garden good with recipes to suit your mood. Try some grub you've never tried before. Smash it with a wooden mallet, gonna educate your palate right here in Farmer's Kitchen. In Tino Farmer's Country Kitchen. We're gonna cook something good now.
Hello and welcome to Tim Farmer's Country Kitchen. Is it not a beautiful day?
It is, finally.
And the weather is crazy this year. Mm-hmm. Cold, warm, threat of snow, 75 degrees. But you know what? We'll take our days outside and we'll take those days to cook. We'll also take those days and check on our critters. Mm-hmm. Now, every day we spend time with our animals.
Right.
Can I tell your secret again?
You can tell it.
Every now and then. It may be a puppy thing, maybe a lamb thing, or maybe just sitting after dinner talking.
Right.
She'll get a little tear in her eye and say, I love our farm.
I do. Don't make fun of me.
And
love babies.
You always wanted that.
I always wanted a farm.
Growing up, and you know what? There is something so special. We don't have a huge amount of land here. We've got a tiny little farm, but you know what? It's just enough. But the one thing that we do need to do when it's nice weather is have our friend Beth out.
That's right.
Now, she is a veterinarian for the state. She goes around and she educates people and she talks to groups about all kinds of farm animals. She knows everything about every animal you can imagine.
What a fun job.
Yeah. But anyway, we're going to do a very, very simple recipe tonight. When you're just hungry and you just want something that's really tasty and really good and really easy. But first of all, let's go visit with Beth. We're going to take a look at the lambs and our one and only world famous alpaca, Milton.
I love Milty. I get to hold him. Kind of.
Sort of.
Yeah.
Beth is back and it's about time.
Yes, it is.
We got all kinds of weird stuff going on. You know what? As you're looking around,
everybody looks very, very healthy. We've got some lambs here that were born in January and they're definitely performing quite up to standard.
Well, we like our sheep, and hopefully the sheep like us. Now, we'll have to take a look at that little guy's leg who we dutied up. See what you think.
We'll have to see. He's bearing weight on it.
Yeah, he is.
So it's definitely looking promising that he's going to heal up. That's one of the problems with little kids and little lambs is they like to play.
So that's common. And
yes, it is common. And they like to play, and they like to stick their legs where they're not supposed to be. And they do break their legs every once in a while when they do that. But it is, you know, if you just go the extra mile and just splint it, and they do get better. You know, we can see the callus formation is right here. So what we're going to do, when you're trying to stabilize these legs, what you want to do is go above and below the joint, below the fracture, I mean. So we want to really take the bandage up just a little bit higher right here. Now we can let him walk on his foot. That's not a problem. But what we want to do is and I'm going to show you how to put a piece of tape here that'll keep that bandage up. Okay? And when you're applying a bandage, you don't want to apply it too tight but firm. And you take your first wrap around. Like I said, you want to kind of go above the knee because you want to stabilize that joint as well. And this is where we're going to incorporate your fancy sticks. And you're wanting to put that right at the fracture to stabilize that fracture. And then you do this, and that keeps that bandage from slipping down.
Okay.
Boy, isn't duct tape great?
It's awesome.
Well, I tell you what, he's healing up quicker than I am, but he's a lot younger than I am, too.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about a lot of things today. You know, raising sheep is not just putting a fence around them and letting them go. There's a lot involved. One of the simple things that I don't think we've even covered yet, and I want to talk to you about, is why are these sheep wearing an ear tag? And at what point are you supposed to put an ear tag in them?
Right.
And how do you put an ear tag in them? And which leads to the question, what is scrapies?
Scrapies, it's a federal program. The tags, like in my herd, I put the tags in when the kids are about 2 days old. And it's before the kids go out with the rest of the herd. And it's a form of identification.
Gotcha.
Well, the scrapie program nationally is a animal disease traceability is what the national program is all about. Scrapie is a disease. It is a very chronic, progressive disease. Usually doesn't show up in sheep until they're like 6 or 7 years of age. But the reason why this tag was introduced is so that we could trace that animal back to its birthplace.
Wow, I did not know that. I learned something today, man.
And so that's why we do the scrapie tag, and it's extremely important. In Kentucky, every animal that goes to a market has to have a scrapie tag in it before it's sold.
Gotcha.
If you look on the inside of the ear, it's right between the rib. There's a rib here of the ear and a rib here. If you go in between the ribs, you miss the veins. So in my herd, I do, the boys get a tag in the right ear and the girls get a tag in the left ear. And that way, when I'm looking at a kid, I know which one's a girl and which one's a boy.
Right off the bat. You get that much salt.
You already know.
So that's why we do that. Now, we are thinking about, now some people are going, but we're thinking about eating some of these young males.
Yep.
So what process has to take place if we're going to do that?
What you want to do is you want to get your, you don't want to process a lamb or a kid until it's about 60 to 70 pounds. That's the preferred weight. Now, it depends on whether you want to get to 60 or 70 pounds at 5 months of age or if you want them to be 60 or 70 pounds at 8 or 9 months of age. If you want them to be young, weaned right off the mama, and then eaten in, say, like a month or two after you've weaned them, then you're going to have to feed them a little bit of grain.
Right.
And that grain can be corn, but preferably a complete pellet, and probably somewhere in the neighborhood of a 14 to 16% protein feed. And then you can process that animal a little bit quicker. If you want to stay just with a forage-based system, then you're probably looking at processing them when they're 8 or 9 months of age.
What do you actually have to do? I mean, how can we say this on television, keep it PG-13? What do we have to do to get them ready for that process?
Okay, what we generally like to do, male lambs or kids reach sexual maturity at about 4 to 5 months of age.
Right.
So it would be definitely advisable if you're going to keep one for processing, you probably want to go ahead and band it when it's a young kid or lamb somewhere in the neighborhood. You know, we are going to band these little guys now, and sheep can be done when as soon, approximately about a week of age. Goats do not band until they're about 2 months of age.
Now, when you say band, is it technically just a band?
It is a band that goes on their scrotal sac, and you're literally, that's our form of castration.
Gotcha.
And what I do is I just pull the scrotal sac down, and then I put pressure at the base of the scrotum to make sure both testicles are down in that sac. And then I release my band, pull off, and then make sure you can feel two testicles in that sac. This is the classic stance of a lamb that's been banded. They're going to do this for about a couple hours. If you want to, there is some pain medicine that you could give them. It's called meloxicam. That'll help them.
But they
just want to lay around.
Previous to that, do you give them something to keep them from getting an infection? Or?
Yeah. What we do is when you're banding these animals, they have to be protected against tetanus.
Right.
Tetanus is a disease that once they contract it, there's no treatment. So it's extremely important that you, when administering a band to a young lamb or a kid, what we're going to do with these guys is we're going to actually give them a tetanus antitoxin. And the tetanus antitoxin has to go in the muscle. Right, like that. Because the ewes were not vaccinated 30 days before lambing, and so they didn't have high antibody titers in their colostrum against tetanus. We're also going to give them a toxoid today. That'll be their first CDT, is what they call it. Protects against Clostridium perfringens type C and D and tetanus. I put it right here on the side of his chest floor, under the skin. I pinch their skin so that they don't usually feel the needle going in. And we're going to give them that initial toxoid booster today, and then in 3 to 4 weeks they get their booster. That protects them from that point on for overeating disease and tetanus.
Gotcha.
And we're also going to dock their tails. at the same time.
Well, let's talk about that.
Yep.
What's...
Why would we dock, you know, especially with hair sheep? A lot of hair sheep do not, as this ewe here, you can see, has a long tail, and you don't have to dock hair sheep, but if they were to develop diarrhea or anything like that, the feces will collect on the tails, and is extremely important in wool sheep. The flies love to go to the tails with a lot of stool on them, and they'll do what they call fly strike, and maggots will set up, and it's a pretty nasty disease.
We don't want that.
So that's why we're going to go ahead and dock these guys' tails.
Okay.
When you're doing the tail, it's extremely important that you leave at least 2 digits on the tail, enough to cover his rectal area.
This will just fall off.
So this is the same thing that you use for his other body
right.
part.
It's just an elastrator. Pull that off, and so you can see that that's just barely cover it. Okay. The other thing we're going to do is we're going to give these ewes, they've all had their initial, and they're going to get their booster CDT, and then we're also going to check their, we're going to trim their hooves. I generally just routinely deworm at lambing though, but because their immune system is really weak and it just really pays to deworm the ewes. This little tip here has to go to the very back of the throat, and it stimulates the esophageal groove, and the wormer goes into where it's supposed to go. It doesn't drop into the rumen, it goes straight to the stomach, and that's extremely important. Anytime you're deworming a big group of animals, you want to look at their eye color, which we'll look at these guys' eye color as well. And the best place to give a alpaca a dose is right behind their elbow right here. Okay, grab his head like that. There you go. And I find this non-haired area right there. And I pinch the skin up, and I'm kind of like doing this blind just because I've done a bunch of them. And their skin is very tough, so be used to that. And then we're going to go ahead and deworm them. And they're a little bit of a challenge to deworm. But, and I generally, when I put it in there, I let them chew on it a little bit, because guess what? When they're chewing, what are they doing? Swallowing. Okay, and then you can turn them loose.
Well, you see all of them. You think we're in pretty good shape?
I think so.
Well, I thank you so much for coming out and sharing information, which
sure.
that's what you do.
That's what
you
I do.
You get to go all over the place, and you got a pretty cool job.
I do. I have met so many people working with the state vet's office, and really enjoy my small ruminant, you know, producers and helping with them.
Well, we so appreciate what you do. Thanks
thank
for coming
you.
Out.
Thank you.
See, Milty, I told you, Tim, I would hold him someday. if it wasn't for Beth grabbing him.
All right, so you got some friends coming out. And you're like, oh, my goodness, we got nothing except some chicken thighs. Mm-hmm. I, by choice, only buy thighs.
It tastes
better. More flavorful.
Right.
That's just
more tender.
These are skinless because
we're being healthy.
I've got some of that winter weight
that
I'm trying desperately to lose.
Really? And they're boneless, too.
They're boneless. So we're going to do some quick and easy stuff. There's just a few little tricks here. I like these little colored potatoes. Now, how are you going to fix a potato on a fire? You can put them in aluminum foil and let them sit there for hours and hours and hours. Or you can take these little smaller potatoes, maybe lightly blanch them, just enough to soften them up a bit. Put them on a skewer. Take a little Italian dressing.
Yum.
Salt and pepper.
Yum. Ta-da. Good idea.
Nothing to it. Now we're going to take some corn on the cob, but Kelly was telling me about a little trick to keep the moisture in. Season it, wet the paper towel, put it around it. That way, if the aluminum burns, it won't, you know,
you
go
kind of
under
steam
the corn.
It
and it steams
steam.
It up because the moisture's in there. Now, have you ever had Italian dressing on corn on the cob?
No, but I'm looking forward to it.
I'm just going to do a couple.
Okay,
see if you like
good.
It. We'll do some butter
and
some of that. We already got it out here.
Let's try it. I like that.
You've seen us use a lot of mustard. I like mustard. Some people, even if you don't like mustard, if you have tried mustard and you absolutely hate it, if you use it in a barbecue type setting and you use it just as a sealant or just on the edges, when it cooks over a fire or you smoke something with, I'd say, a dry rub and a mustard, you don't taste the mustard. You just taste the tanginess.
It's yummy.
And it kind of forms a crust. It's absolutely wonderful. So, dry rubs. I spent 30 years messing around with dry rubs. And I kept changing it and changing it and changing it. It still changes every day. But I have one that I'm getting mighty close on. I challenge you to go to the kitchen. You can go to the store and buy all kinds of dry rubs. That's easy. But if you take your basic things like paprika, a little bit of cayenne, some black pepper, I like a little bit of cumin, a little garlic, and a little onion powder. Just keep going adding the things that you like. Before long, you're going to come up with something really special. I like a little bitty brown sugar in it, too. Some people like their sweet, some people don't. Of course, you can use kosher salt, you can use whatever you want. Experiment yourself until you get it just like you like it. So, as my mouth waters, because I know what's about to happen here, I'm going to ask you, Mrs. Farmer, if you would, to take some of our little potatoes, and we're going to put those on skewers. Then we're going to put just a little bit of Italian dressing on them, and then we'll put a tad of salt and pepper on them. And they're going to come off there ready to roll. Look at that. Not that right there. Just that right there. It looks... Oh, look at that.
Yum.
You know what? We're going to set that off to the side. Now we're going to rig a couple of these up.
Okay.
Let's go ahead and take a little piece of foil. Let's get this paper towel here. So we're just going to take a little bit. See what I'm saying?
Like that,
put on here. We don't have to worry about that flaring up inside of there. We're going to roll this around. Everybody said, oh, you're heavy on the oil here tonight. But hey, we're in a hurry. We got all these people coming over.
That's right.
So roll that up. That way it keeps the moisture in. The oil won't burn. Now, here's the other one we're going to do. This is going to give it that steamed effect.
Okay.
Just a little bit here and there.
I like your steam.
And let's just go ahead and put that on here.
A little melted butter.
Just a little melted butter. So this is going to keep our moisture in. Nothing can burn. A little salt and pepper.
Yum.
Are you kidding me?
Wrap it up.
You like where we're going?
I do. This is interesting.
All right, now I'm going to set these out of the direct fire. It's hot, but I'm going to keep moving around. Some of them closer to the flame. I'm using my little snake today because we don't have to get these real, real hot. I'm going to take my potatoes. I'm going to put them right back here. And you can see that we got plenty of fire back here. Think about this. When you got a flame going, you got some oil, you got to keep things moving around. You got to keep an eye on it. You can't walk away from this type of dinner. So here we got, I mean, this is nothing special. This is nothing hard to do.
But
let me tell you what, Italian dressing, you can't beat it. And so I'm going to put my dry rub on the top side here. Then we'll put it on the fire. Put that side on the bottom, and then we'll come back and hit the top. So look what we got going right here. Now we come back with our dry rub, and look what we got. Now see what I'm doing here is the mustard.
Like that,
I want to get your ideas on this. Again, if you don't like mustard, I would recommend you try this because something happens, some kind of magic tang happens when you put your mustard on your pork or your chicken. I'm going to do the same thing with this. I'm going to put it on the fire, turn it over. And just like that, we got us a cowboy meal going. All right, now I'm going to go ahead and put the corn up. It's over here, but it's not quite hot enough. So I'm going to put it on here and let it start warming up. Everything's over the fire. Well, here in Kentucky, you know, people are crazy about their basketball. We know that. Whether you're red or blue, I bet we can find a drink for you. That was poetic. Alex is back.
I am.
What we had tonight?
March Madness mojitos.
Don't you love March Madness?
I do love March Madness, if Kentucky's in there.
Our viewing audience in Kentucky is statewide.
Mm-hmm.
So what do we do about that?
Well, we're going to have two,
okay.
A blue one and a red one.
Aha.
I've covered all the bases.
Okay, covered all the bases. I'm probably going to take the blue one.
Yeah, me too. But the red one is still
okay.
Tasty. It's
all right.
Fine.
All right. How do you do that? Let's see what we're doing.
All right, so to start, we're going to add some mint. It's the base of all mojitos.
There you go.
We'll make these at the same time, to be fair.
And we might mention that if you would like to plant some mint anywhere around your house, give it a little bit of sun.
Yeah.
It'll take off.
Absolutely. You don't even have to really do anything about
mint
it.
Everywhere.
I hardly ever water mine, and it's gross. It's so big, yeah. So very easy. You don't always have to buy mint. So mint and lime are the basis of all mojitos.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to throw a lime in each of these. This is the L8 ginger infused simple syrup that I've had a few times on your show.
What's the breakdown of that again, one more time?
Sugar, water, and L8 suckers. And if you don't have the L8 suckers, you just do sugar, half a cup of water, half a cup of L8. Simmer it, let it chill in the fridge, and you're good to go. Super easy. So I like my mojitos to be pretty sweet, so I put in probably about 4 tablespoons.
That
you definitely don't have to.
Really, really good.
I know, it smells very, it smells like I want some here.
You know, it smells like Mexico.
It does, or Cuba, yeah. Or any of those places. All right, so you have your simple syrup, your mint, and your lime. You're gonna get a muddle. This is just a mortar and pestle. If you don't have a muddle, you can find something. It's basically just to smash the lime.
Go cut your stick.
Get a stick if you want to. We're in Kentucky, but you
deer antler.
Deer antler works. Basically, you just want the lime juice and the oil from the lime skin to kind of come out and infuse in your glass. Make sure you don't splash yourself in the eye while you're doing this. It has happened before. Pretty simple.
You're not spending any less time on the...
Same time. Now, for the Louisville one, we're going to add some strawberries.
Okay.
Get your red in. UK, of course, we're gonna do blueberries.
Gotcha.
Now, what I'm gonna do here to make these a little easier to muddle, you'll open up some L8, get a little liquid going.
And I just gotta say, you gotta give credit where credit's due. Both teams are doing really well this year.
They really are.
Proud of them both.
Hey, we're both from Kentucky. It's Kentucky. That's what matters,
they
right?
They really are doing good this year. I'm proud of them both.
We're also going to shake these back and forth, so that'll also break it up. There's that. Now we add some ice to each glass.
Right.
For Kentucky Blue, we add a little bit of blue curacao, probably about half an ounce.
Gotcha.
It's not necessary, but it'll definitely give it that great blue flavor, or blue color, and it has the citrus flavor to go along with the mojito. Or Louisville, you can just eyeball a little bit of cranberry juice. And of course, rum is the basis of a mojito. We're gonna go to the full size jigger. This is 1.5 ounces. It's a standard shot.
You know what? Those are pretty.
Right?
Very pretty drinks.
And then you can shake. I just like to toss back and forth. I think it works just as well. All the flavors mixed in together. Top these off with a little bit of L8.
Got your fizz and your sweetness and your ginger.
Garnish with a sprig of mint. Strawberry to Louisville. Has some blueberries to float on top for UK. And there.
Look at that.
Some gorgeous mojitos for March Madness.
All bases
covered. Covers all the bases for Kentucky.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Beautiful. I don't know if it gets any easier than that. And this is another one of those things where we thought, well, maybe that's too easy.
Looks pretty, though. Look at it.
All right, so I want you to try the mustard first.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Now try the Italian dressing.
I like them both.
Which one do you like the best, though?
They're both delicious.
That's rough.
I know, it's really good. They're both good, aren't they? I almost kind of like the mustard, and I'm an Italian dressing person.
Wow.
You like the Italian dressing?
No, I think I like the mustard.
I do, too. There's something about that mustard taste.
No, I'm not saying I don't like the Italian dressing. I want to eat every bit of that. You know, that's really good. All right, now
I want
you to try the corn.
Okay.
The butter.
That's the butter
versus
corn.
The Italian dressing. I don't know if you can eat butter and corn.
Delicious.
Of course.
Mm-hmm.
Now try the Italian dressing.
It has a little tang to it. I like it. It's a little different.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What do you think? I like that. I like them both. But that does have a little tang with the Italian dressing. I kind of like that.
Want to try one of your potatoes?
I would love to.
One off the end there.
Wow.
They're yummy.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are curious about other recipes that we might have, where would you find them?
I would go to timfarmerscountrykitchen.com, and I do. You know that.
I know.
All the time.
Because sometimes
we forget
how much
we measure.
We actually go there. timfarmerscountrykitchen.com, click on YouTube, and there's a gazillion shows there that you can watch. And if you have not signed up to our Facebook page, what are you waiting on? Where are you at?
That's right.
You have to become one of our friends on Tim Farmer's Country Kitchen Facebook page. We have a bunch of friends over there. We talk, we share recipes, and we jabber back and forth. You know what? So pretty much it's all about
good times,
good friends,
and all these good eats.
And we're going to eat them. We better leave Kelly something, or she
sure
might not be happy.
Leave her just a little.
All right, I'm going after this
mushroom. I like the corn.
To order a cookbook or DVD of the show, please call 502-319-0487 or email timfarmerck@gmail.com. Special thanks to CKY, Canoe, Kentucky. Furniture World Superstore. Housewarmings. Lodge Cast Iron. Tater Knob Pottery and Farm.